Hello and welcome to video lecture series in sociology. Today we are going to discuss chapter 1 titled as Structural Changes from your textbook Social Change and Development in India. This chapter discusses the impact of colonial rule on Indian society, which means how the British influenced the nature and structure of Indian society, economy and polity, with particular focus on processes of urbanization and industrialization and what sort of structural changes both these processes had on Indian society. To begin our discussion on structural changes, let us begin by understanding how do we define a structure or what is meant by a structure. Simply stating, a structure is an arrangement, a pattern and relationship between different parts of something. You can also say structure means the way various activities are organized. For example, how do we impart justice defines nature of legal structure of any society, or how do we get educated defines the educational structure. In the same way, family, kinship, religion, all these institutions have different kinds of structures. Structural changes mean or imply transformation or changes in the way structures are organized or in the way these relations and activities are organized. For instance, delivering lectures on smart boards can be labeled as change in one aspect of the educational structure, that is, method of teaching. Our previous generations did not have this advantage. The question is, how do we study this change or transformation? The answer is, the changes can be understood in terms of two dimensions. Number one, their causes, that is, what factors bring about change, or what are the reasons behind change. Second, we can study transformation in terms of consequences, that is, what has actually changed or undergone transformation. So, in the example of change in the educational structure, what do you think are the causes of change? One may say that development of means of communication and technology is the factor or motor behind change. In terms of consequences, the method of teaching has undergone transformation. IT has changed the way students can be taught now. Teaching has gone beyond the time and space dimensions of your classroom. Your teacher now is located at a distance. Someone may ask here that how do we assess change or how do we say something has changed? We measure changes by comparing one particular structure at two points of time. This is also called as dichronic comparison. We can compare any institution at two points of time, for instance, family in 1950s and 2010, after a gap of 60 years. In 1950s, nuclear families were not there in existence, whereas joint families were more in number. After 60 years, we see growing number of nuclear families and joint family number coming down. To compare present with past, some understanding of history of that society is necessary. In case of India, we can say that India has a long and rich history. Knowing about our ancient and medieval times is important, but it is the colonial experience that is most significant to comprehend reality of modern India. In this chapter, we will focus on changes brought in by colonialism in India, that is, the British Empire. We know in history, India was conquered several times by different groups of people who ruled different parts of what we now know as modern India. But Western colonialism, that is the British, had the greatest impact on our society. Why is it so? To understand this, we have to understand the difference between the empire building of pre-capitalist times and the empire building of the capitalist times. The pre-capitalist conquerors appropriated the economic surplus without interfering with the economic organization of our society. On the contrary, colonialism in capitalist era is of different kind. What does that mean? To understand it, let us briefly discuss what is meant by capitalism first. Capitalism is an economic system in which the means of production are privately owned and organized to accumulate profits within a market system. What does that mean? It means that the decision regarding what to produce, how to produce, and how much to produce is left to the market forces of demand and supply. Capitalism emerged in West as a consequence of unique combination of factors. What were these factors? These factors were some of the intellectual and philosophical revolution that happened in Europe around 16th and 17th century. To begin with, it started with Reformation and Enlightenment, which challenged the tradition and religion. Social and political revolutions were French Revolution happened to establish democracy, Industrial Revolution that led to growth of science and technology, and discovery of new lands for resources, which led to imperialism and colonialism later on. Together, these forces led to transformation of economic, political, and social structure of Europe forever. What happened as a consequence? Capitalism defined the economic organization. Democracy became the dominant political form, and social organization became modern. It was characterized by rational, scientific tempo. It would be interesting for you to explore what is meant by modernity. What are the features of modernity? Coming back to our discussion of impact of colonial rule on Indian society, the British colonialism in India is an example of empire building of capitalist times. It directly interfered with the economic organization of India and altered its nature to ensure greatest benefits and profit to their empire back home. So, unlike the previous conquerors, why the British had the greatest impact on India? The reason was that they introduced and modified social, economic, and political structures for their benefit. Every policy initiated by the British was geared towards strengthening and expansion of British capitalism and making their empire strong. What did they change? Or, for that matter, what kind of changes or modifications the British introduced in India? The British changed the law of the land and forest, thereby depriving villagers, farmers, and tribals from their important source of sustenance. You know that villager, farmers, and tribals' livelihood is related to land and collection of resources from forest. However, by changing the law of the land and forest, they deprived many people from their basic source of income and earning. The British decided what to produce and what not to produce. They meddled with the manufacturing sector and changed the way production and distribution of goods was done conventionally. Many of our present-day institutions were introduced by and still are modeled on the lines of British institutions. For instance, the legal system. We have three levels of judiciary: the District Court, the High Court, and the Supreme Court. This system was initiated by the British in India. Our education system, the schooling, the university pattern, and the kind of degrees we award and the disciplines we have were also introduced by the British education system. The political system. We have parliamentary democracy with two houses called as Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, which are equivalent to the lower house and the upper house. Many of our practices are also part of our culture, and they are influenced by colonial legacy. For example, we wear neckties in school, or we use fork and knives in restaurants, even to eat something like South Indian cuisine. For a while, think of the ways in which English language has become part of our everyday life. It is the basic means of communication everywhere. Knowledge of English helps you in almost every aspect of life, be it job interview, writing, advertising, learning. It has penetrated in our culture so deeply. Even the matrimonial ads ask for convent-educated brides or grooms. The reason is that knowing English is equated with being modern and presentable in our society. Colonialism also resulted in movement of people from one area to another. Any movement of people from one area to another is called as process of migration. You can have various streams of migration. Most of the time, the famous stream is from rural to urban areas, but it can also happen from urban areas to rural areas, which is called as reverse migration. At times, it also happens from rural to rural areas, mostly in the case of marriages, or from urban to urban areas. This movement occurred within India in search for jobs, mostly to the cities and centers for commerce and industry. That does not mean people did not go out. People also went to other colonies of the British in Asia, Africa, and America as workers in agricultural and manufacturing sector. Some of this movement was voluntary, but some of the movement was forced upon people to work in other colonies and agricultural sector. To facilitate smooth functioning of its rule, the British introduced many changes in every sphere of activity. Some of these changes were intended, and some of them were unintended consequences. What do you mean by intended changes? Intended means something that you take as a deliberate action to achieve a purpose or a goal. And what do you mean by unintended, or unintended consequence for that matter, is something which you had not thought about before taking the intended step. For example, the British introduced English education to create a class of Indians who will help them in managing their empire. They introduced railways and means of transportation to help in their business. On the contrary, these intended changes or modifications resulted in rise of nationalistic and anti-colonial sentiment. How? People from different parts of India travelled from one place to another. They came in contact with one another and identified that liberty is what they are striving for. British rule was suppressing their liberation, and that is how, with printing, with exchange of information, dissemination of information and knowledge, the rise of nationalistic sentiment gained momentum. Many of our freedom strugglers are part of this educated class also, those who were barristers or lawyers or practiced law, such as Mahatma Gandhi in South Africa, those who realized that India needs to gain freedom. So what happened as a consequence of intended change led to contrary consequences, that is unintended one. Two important changes that are discussed in detail in this chapter are processes of industrialization and urbanization. Industrialization, which means introduction of factory-based production that changes nature of economic structure of any society, here in India. And urbanization means migration of people primarily from rural areas to urban areas, which leads to growth of cities and urban center. Both these processes are related to one another. Let us understand how process of urbanization and industrialization is related to one another. Industry develops in certain areas depending on many factors, such as availability of land, raw material, labor, energy sources, means of transportation, and many other factors. Once the industry is set in place, it attracts people from neighboring areas to work in these factories. Factories need labor to work. People in search for better prospects move to these areas. What are these better prospects? These can be better income, job, health facility, education facility, better civic and infrastructure. Thus, people from neighboring areas move to these towns and urban centers. That leads to development of cities. To summarize, let us take a quick recap of what we discussed today. We began by discussing what is a structure, how we can understand structural changes in terms of their causes and consequences. In this context, we discussed the difference between the pre-capitalist and capitalist empire building and the associated concept of capitalism. We also discussed what factors changed the nature and structure of European society and led to establishment of modernity. Subsequently, we discussed how the British altered economic organization in India. We discussed the impact of British colonialism on Indian society, economy and polity. In the next part of this chapter, we shall discuss the process of urbanization and industrialization in detail.